Welcome to Ring of Fire. I'm Mike Papantonio. Coming up on today's show, Thom Hartmann's going to explain how our capitalist system has been rigged to destroy the middle class. We'll also explain why the U.S. Chamber of Commerce is pumping millions of dollars into attorney general races. And we'll find out why Cliven Bundy's militia supporters have now burned down. We have all that and more coming up, but right now, just remember, you've stepped in to the Ring of Fire.
You can't change Washington from the inside. You can only change it from the outside.
Grand jury secrecy rules.
For political gain.
The press can find out.
That has nothing to do with politics, but go ahead.
It wouldn't bother me.
Oops.
The U.S. Chamber of Commerce is pumping millions of dollars into attorney general races this year, hoping they can buy enough power to end investigations into corporate crime. If they succeed, there's going to be very little problems for their members the next time they break the law, and I have Howard Nations with me now to talk about that. Howard, you know, it's very typical of progressives to be looking at the shiny things and then having the really bad things taking place while they're not even paying attention to it. I think it was probably 2 years ago, you and I were talking regularly about the idea that the U.S. Chamber of Commerce and industry and the right wing is buying up the courts. And now they've taken it to a whole new level. And that is where now we have those same people buying the attorney generals of each state. Obviously, it's pretty clear on why they're doing that. Let's talk about it.
Okay, Mike. You know, a recent example really shows what's happening in this. In the Nevada Attorney General race, the Secretary of State, Ross Miller, is running unopposed in a primary. And yet, 3 months before the election, $500,000 ad campaign smearing him, ad hominem attacks on him, are running 3 months before an unopposed primary. Why? Well, because it is outside money that's being put in, and it traces right back to the Chamber of Commerce because they're trying to attack him early. The Chamber of Commerce, through its Institute for Legal Reform,
Howard, to me, it's interesting on why this is taking place. Why are they going after the attorney generals? It's pretty obvious. I mean, if you practice law like you and I do, the attorney general is the one that goes after corporations when they commit crimes. So if you can have the hand-pick attorney general, that's a pretty good deal, isn't it?
Yeah, there are two great reasons for them why they're going after attorney generals. One is AGs are laughingly called AG, almost governor. There are eight current governors and eight current senators who came up through the ranks as attorney general. But the real major reason is that is the power of the attorney general. The power of the attorney general to their job is to sue or not to sue, to protect the public and consumers' rights, human rights, voters' rights, civil rights. But more importantly to the corporations, they have the power to prosecute or not. They can prosecute corporate fraud and corruption. They have the choice to prosecute whistleblower cases. To choose to prosecute or not healthcare fraud, polluters, mass tort feasors like tobacco industry, and they're very, very important. They have a very important role in reapportionment. But well, if you look at, for example, if you look at Elliot Spitzer, what he did as the New York Attorney General, he was known as the Sheriff of Wall Street. He sought both civil remedies and criminal remedies.
Howard, one thing we saw, I mean, you know, we've talked about tobacco. For example, if the attorney generals throughout the United States had not been willing to get involved and go after the tobacco companies, it would have been virtually impossible to have them pay for the hundreds of billions of dollars that had been squandered in Medicare and Medicaid in each state because of tobacco-related illnesses that taxpayers had to end up paying for rather than the tobacco company. Isn't that kind of a prime example of how the attorney general, if they're effective, can really bring about social change?
Well, the tobacco settlement was not only a prime example, it was the wake-up call to corporate wrongdoers. The Colorado attorney general, who's an exec on the Republican Attorney General's Committee, said that attorney generals can do more damage than a legislature can to corporate tortfeasors. And they can either choose to do so or not. As we see today, the D.C., the U.S. Attorney General, is chosen to protect wrongdoers. Wall Street stole $1 trillion from the American public. The only person who went to jail was Martha Stewart. On the tobacco litigation, the lawyers, the trial lawyers, went out, worked on contingent fees. They did all the work, 100% of the work. They paid all the expenses. They completely prepared the case, and they took these cases to attorneys general. Now, the attorneys general had the choice at that point. They could either prosecute or not based upon the work of the trial lawyers. And the ones that chose to prosecute and to let the trial lawyers prosecute agreed and recovered billions of dollars for their state. That just lit a fire under corporate wrongdoers.
Well, Howard, one thing we see, the Attorney General is also very critical where it comes to arguing in front of the Supreme Court of the state. So, for example, if Exxon or these people, the Koch brothers, or of course, their money is hugely behind this, with the Chamber of Commerce, if any of their people are being attacked because they've committed crimes, they've injured people, they've committed fraud, they've stolen pension money from mom and pop, they've made a product that leaves a child blind or deaf. A lot of times that issue goes all the way up to the state Supreme Court on constitutional issues. And so the state attorney general is the person that makes that argument to the Supreme Court. Well, isn't it great if you own the attorney general? If you're Exxon and you've paid to have that attorney general elected, then isn't that kind of clear sailing for you?
Well, if you're one of the major polluters in the world, as in the Koch brothers, and you have an attorney general who can decide to prosecute you or not, that's very nice also. What the chamber realizes is that they can achieve protection of corporate wrongdoers if they have attorneys general who will refuse to prosecute consumer cases. And they banded together after the tobacco litigation. They formed the Attorney General's Associations, Republican and Democratic Attorney General's Associations. The chamber has given 100 times greater contributions to the Republicans than to the Democrats, which tells you a lot. And the tobacco industry gave $7.5 million to the Republicans, $500,000 to the Democrats. So yeah, they're very strongly engaged in trying to buy up the attorneys general now who make the decisions as to whether or not to prosecute them.
Why have progressives been so dull? Why have they been so just absolute brain dead where it comes to understanding that the U.S. Chamber of Commerce has us paying attention to House races and even the White House, where state by state people's rights are being dismantled? We can almost ignore what happens in Washington if we're under attack in our state by state. Attorney generals are out there in front of corporations. That's all the corporation cares about. So progressives have been absolutely brain dead where it comes to this issue. You know, we thought, oh, Obama was really going to be such an important race. Obama has been insignificant. He's done really very little for progressives. But state by state, progressives have been under attack through things like judge races, attorney general races. Right now, there are 31 of them that are pending. I mean, how do we turn that around, Howard?
Well, it was actually turned around against the Democrats, because at the time of the tobacco litigation, Democrats held the attorney general positions in the country by 3-1. As of today, Democrats have only one. They're only one ahead of Republicans on attorney general. So they've done an extremely good job of picking off attorneys general, while the progressives have slept, been asleep at the wheel, and they're now turning themselves back to the super PACs after Citizens United are now going into judicial races. The latest example, in 2012, there were $30 million was put into television in judicial races. And these are almost invariably attacks on judges or on judicial candidates. And they're attacking judges, even though their agenda is to have judges who will rule for them in civil cases and who will not prosecute, who will not find against them in criminal cases. Their agenda is to attack the judges on their criminal records, on the records that they have in prosecuting on criminal cases, because that's where they're most vulnerable. But they're focusing heavily now on the courts, the way they've been focusing in the past on legislatures and governorships and attorneys general.
So, Howard, in your professional opinion, I mean, you know, you've been practicing law an awful long time. You've seen what attorney generals are able to do to cause harm to consumers when they're on the side or in the pocket of corporate America. If you had to make a choice, say, look, what's more important to the average voter out there? Is it something like an AG race or a judge's race? Or is it more important that they put all of their time and money towards the presidency? I mean, I know what I think about it. I think we've just been, I think the whole issue's been totally mishandled by Democrats and progressives. And in our own backyard, we're getting killed.
Well, to answer your question, Mike, there's only one attorney general. In many states, there are 7 or 9 Supreme Court judges. So it's far easier to buy one attorney general who will not prosecute you, who will not protect consumers, who will not act at all on behalf of the public, but act to protect the Chamber of Commerce and its members. Much easier to get one attorney general than it is to get 5 out of 9 judges.
Yeah. Howard Nations, thanks for joining us. This is a story I hope people are going to pay attention to, because it's going to have a big, big impact on politics of the future. Thank you for joining me.
Thank you, Mike.
Cliven Bundy has shied away from the media spotlight since his racist comments became public, but his right-wing militia followers are getting crazier by the minute, and now they've actually turned on each other. Joining me now to talk about the latest development with the Bundy saga is author David Neiwert. You know, David, a psychiatrist could take the DSM-4 and look under delusional kinds of terms, and they would kind of get a picture of what we have working out on the Bundy Ranch. You've got these cats that think they're in the midst of the old cowboy days fighting Indians. Another part of them believe that they're playing G.I. Joe, Rambo, Militia. It when you look at it, it's almost like delusional children. And you come away thinking, Jesus, it's such childlike analysis of reality that you understand that it has the potential to get out of control, because it's like children with guns, isn't it?
Yeah, a lot of these are folks who, you know, didn't actually pay attention during civics class in high school.
Yeah.
And figured out later that this stuff actually impacts your lives. And so they often attach to a very shallow and sort of superficial approach to politics and government, sort of based on, you know, basically wrapping yourself in a flag. And I think it makes them very susceptible to all kinds of afactual appeals, particularly the conspiracist type, the John Birch Society type, which is really what underlays a lot of this mentality. This is stuff that's been going on for years. You know, I grew up around this stuff in southern Idaho, and it's in a lot of ways, it's almost in the genes.
Yeah, I just started to say, you almost look at it and you say, well, this has got to be in their DNA. Yeah. And it's not, you know, you want all them, all, you almost want to say, well, it's just DNA crazy. But really what it is DNA gullible. It's DNA that causes them to get sucked into every kind of conspiracy nut idea that comes along. You know, day one, they're a teabagger. Day two, they're a militiaman. Day three, they're a cowboy riding a horse carrying an American flag across the Bundy Ranch. And it's the same mixture. I mean, as much as I read about it, that's my simple conclusion. I don't know how else to put it.
Well, having spent a lot of time with these folks, I can tell you that they're not stupid, which is what a lot of people assume. A lot of them are actually very intelligent, but they have very elaborated worldviews. But these worldviews are predicated on some really foundational problems. And one of them is kind of a paranoid worldview, also a very sort of provincial. So, this is what I know, this is what I know of the world, and this is the way the world should work. They're really susceptible to, you talked about their gullibility, but it's a very selective gullibility. Part of the mentality is that they refuse to believe anything that comes from mainstream media or anything, because they think you're being gullible for buying into that, right? So they actually have this very deep skepticism, but it's a very selective skepticism because they're incredibly gullible for anything that comes along and basically confirms what is already there.
Well, you talk about their intelligence, but I mean, everybody watching this has sat down with somebody who you might expect to show up at the Bundy Ranch, or might expect to be, you know, dressed up with like George Washington in a teabagger movement. We've all talked to them, and they all. What's I think most aggravating is they give you this aura that they know more than everybody else. That everybody else is simply stupid. That they've looked at something that we haven't seen. It's almost as if they have their secret papers at home, and they're able to tell now. As you watch this, though, as you cover this story, by the way, your coverage is the only thing that I really rely on. Your coverage on this is excellent because I think it gets down to these very issues. It's almost like children now who've started fighting among themselves. Talk about that a little bit, how crazy that's become.
Well, right, especially the way they've started, pointing guns at each other and that sort of thing. I mean, a lot of people have suggested that maybe they should just send a drone up over the Bundy Ranch, and that would solve the problem because they'd all start shooting at each other within a few weeks.
Well, there was an issue where they started fighting among themselves because there was this conspiracy idea, which was a complete fraud, that Obama had ordered that drones be sent to the Bundy Ranch. I mean, talk about that.
Well, the rumor came around through the Oath Keepers that the Bundy Ranch, that Obama had, Eric Holder had signed off on a drone attack on the Bundy Ranch. And so the Oath Keepers people, Stuart Rhodes and all of his people, went running into the camp and said, well, we got to, you know, everybody should be prepared for this. And he suggested that a few of his people, particularly a woman with children, should actually leave the camp. Next thing they knew, they were being accused of cowardice. And in fact, I think
by another faction within the group. In other words, you had the, what are they called? The Oath Keepers? And yeah,
that was Rhodes and his faction.
Okay, so you got the Oath Keepers now being accused by another faction of desertion or something like that.
Yeah, cowardice, of deserting the field of combat.
Jeez.
Because they wanted, actually, they just really wanted to go get a motel room and get a shower.
Yeah. And so what ended up happening was you had the two camps that start pointing fingers and actually pointing guns at each other within the Bundy organization.
Yeah. And they were. And I think this kind of, as you suggest, really reflects the underlying sort of worldview that these guys, they actually have constructed this sort of alternative universe for themselves. I mean, this is something that I described about the Patriot and militia movement back in the 90s, that they basically create this alternative universe of stuff that's not real, but, you know, it's this New World Order conspiracy, and they live in this world where, and everything is self-confirming, and anything that doesn't confirm it is rejected. So it becomes a sealed-off sort of sense of reality. And these people can, you know, when they get wound up enough in that world, they can get violent.
Yeah, David, in this past week, you heard all the Tea Partiers, oh, we're going to have the biggest event in the history of America. Millions are going to come to Washington, D.C. on behalf of people like the Oath Keepers and Cliven Bundy and the teabaggers and the really frenzy right-wing nuts. All the frenzy right-wing nuts are going to show up in Washington, D.C. Well, there was actually 50 people who actually showed up. And to me, what that is it, doesn't that tell you, first of all, the 50 there were really crazy. I mean, these were the nutty of the nuts. But isn't that a message that maybe most Americans do get it about how crazy these people have become? The whole Tea Party movement. I mean, this is Bundy is a reflection of the Tea Party movement. I mean, the Tea Partiers can try to distance themselves. Republicans can try to distance themselves from it. But it is part of their movement. So 50 people show up in Washington, D.C., and you have to wonder, does the rest of the country understand how crazy these nuts are? I mean, is that what's happening here?
The part of the country that's paying attention does. I think that gradually people are starting to reject this stuff. I think that even very conservative people are getting really uncomfortable with how extreme the rhetoric is becoming. And mostly those folks tend to still be in denial about how radical these people are. And this is part of what the continuing aspect of this story that bothers me is that nobody is really, you know, we had a follow-up protest two weekends ago in Utah, also led by the Bundy people, where they went into a site in Utah that was closed off by the BLM, rode in with their ATVs onto this land that was supposed to be protected because these were Indian archaeological sites, and they were trying to stop the archaeological sites from being degraded. But these Bundy protesters, Bundy ranch folks, showed up to back up what was already a local protest there in Utah. And even, you know what, those folks in Utah really wanted nothing to do with the Bundy ranch people. They kind of broke off into separate factions, even at that protest. I think most Americans have enough sense, of course, to understand that this stuff is not right. I think the media needs to start informing people much better in a much more precise fashion just how radical they really are.
Because well, here you had, David, you had these lunatics that were stopping people, just regular citizens that happened to live around the Bundy Ranch, told them they couldn't use the public roads, asking them for identification, telling them that they had to turn their car around and go home, that they couldn't drive down a public road. And the media yawned. The media, corporate media at least, acted like that wasn't important. I mean, really?
Well, yeah, I know. Actually, I'll say the local media went out and checked it out. And they couldn't find any evidence that those roadblocks were going on. But a lot of the local residents there were actually talking to their congressmen and saying that they had been stopped by these guys. And sure enough, after a while, a few photos turned up of people being stopped at these roadblocks. So we know that they were occurring. The militiamen denied that they were doing this. But either way, I agree. You know, just the fact that they were doing that should have caught a lot of people's attention.
As you
after the standoff, the media yawned and moved on to the next story.
Yeah, as you point out in this story, it's not over for the real kooks. The FBI is on it. They've got pictures of them. They've got films. They'll quietly take care of this after the Bundy excitement goes on. David Neiwert, as usual, Southern Poverty Law Center, you're a great writer for them. Mark Potok, Morris Dees, all the friends of mine that I'm always amazed at how they see things that corporate media simply ignores. Thank you for joining me, okay?
Thank you, Mike. I should also mention my colleague Ryan Lenz, who's been doing a lot of the coverage.
Oh, yes, for sure, for sure. Well, thanks a lot. Bye-bye. David Neiwert is the author of the book, And Hell Followed With Her. The middle class is disappearing from America, and part of the reason is because the systems have become so rigged that a middle class is no longer possible. Our politics, our laws, our economy, they're all skewed in favor of the 1%, and I have progressive host Thom Hartmann here to talk about how all that happened. Thom, there's been so much discussion with Piketty talking about the flaws of capitalism. And one thing you've been talking about for quite a while is the idea that capitalism never lends itself to a middle class. Capitalism wasn't designed for a middle class. What is your take on that?
Well, that's a very good way to say it. I mean, I wrote a book called Screwed almost a decade ago, pointing this out and going all the way back to the 16th century and the history of capitalism. If you want to know what capitalism normally produces, read any of Charles Dickens's novels. Most people are familiar with A Christmas Carol, and what capitalism produces is a very, very small, very wealthy, basically ruling elite at the top, a relatively small middle class. They're the people who are just necessary to keep everything going, the doctors, the lawyers, the professionals, and the shopkeepers, the mercantilists. And then it produces this huge class of the working poor, the disempowered, disenfranchised working poor. And in, for example, Dickens' Christmas Carol, most people never realized it, and probably as I'm saying it, they'll get, you know, they'll get the, one of these forehead slaps. Oh, Ebenezer Scrooge was not a rich guy in that novel. And in fact, if you read a lot of Dickens' novels, you get it very clearly. He was not a rich guy. He was the middle class. He owned a small business, a two-person business, a business that had one employee. It was a, he was a small businessman. He was not the rich, the very, very rich. And so that kind of society that is described in A Christmas Carol by Charles Dickens, that is what capitalism normally produces.
Well, that's what you would call normal capitalism. And as we read Piketty and we really start understanding what, you know, what this great French economist is trying to tell us, and that is that we have these misconceived notions about what capitalism is supposed to deliver.
Right.
And if we read very carefully, and I haven't had the chance to read it cover to cover, I just bits and pieces of it. It's a big book.
Yeah, it is.
And the point being that he says it's about preserving that 1%. It's almost a royalty class, and we've changed the nature of it. We've kidded ourselves, or maybe it's just been sold to us that this is a system that's going to provide for everybody.
Well, there are two ways that a middle class can emerge in a capitalist society. One is if some external force creates a massive dislocation. And a great example of this is in the 1430s when the Black Death hit Europe and a third of all the people died. Suddenly there was so much demand for labor that the cost of labor more than doubled. And the result of that was that a middle class emerged. It lasted almost three generations, almost 60 years. And the result of that was because people had leisure time, and we had literally what was called the Renaissance, and it led to the creation of poetry and music and art and science and all these things that people could do in their leisure time and in their spare time, and people could get education because they were making enough money as a middle class worker to actually pay for an education or a higher education. And it was this wonderful time in Europe that lasted, like I said, 50, 60 years. And then the population kind of grew back to the point where capitalism could rebalance itself and once again push everybody back down into that bottom end. So number one, you can have crises that produce capitalism. And Piketty is suggesting that in some ways, to some extent, World War II was a crisis like that, particularly for Europe, that produced a middle class. But the second way you can do it is by intentionally changing the rules of the game of capitalism. Capitalism isn't that different from football. There's particular rules. You have rule keepers, you've got referees. You've got boundaries, you've got specific behaviors that are allowed, not allowed. And one of the easiest is taxation. You know, typically when the top tax rate is above 50% after somebody earns $2 or $3 million a year, then you end up with CEOs only making 30 times what average workers do. And the consequence of that is that workers are more well paid. CEOs put their money back into their business and a middle class emerges. And this is, you know, this is what FDR did. He said, I'm going to change the rules of the game of capitalism. And that stood until the Reagan Revolution.
Well, Reagan changed the rules, but for the worse.
Yeah.
I mean, it's all in. We don't have to guess, do we? We don't have to imagine. We don't have to guess. We don't have to speculate at all what Reaganomics did to this country. I mean, it's pretty clear, isn't it?
And we don't have to look to Sweden or Finland or Denmark to try and figure out how to build a strong middle class. We already did it here, and we did it really simply with a rational trade policy, it's a tariff-based trade policy, and high taxes on high earners. I mean, it's pretty simple stuff.
Mm-hmm. Okay, but what ended up happening, 33 years or so, we have been living under this idea that let's just wait a little longer, just wait, because what supply-side economists tell us is going to take hold, and when it does, man, are you going to be happy with it. And we thought that was happening during the Clinton years, didn't we? We thought, okay, this is the Reagan years have created all this prosperity for the Clinton years. But little did we know the Clinton years were a complete fraud. I mean, when it comes to real prosperity, it was all a big bubble. It was all smoke and mirrors. So now we've waited all this time, and in the process of waiting, what have we done step by step to our economy? What things have we done to institute the disappearance of the middle class?
Yeah, well, there's a bunch of them. And I actually kind of go through this list in Crash of 2016, my most recent book. We have deregulated the banks. We've deregulated industry as a whole. We stopped enforcing the Sherman Antitrust Act. So we now have monopolistic control of literally every industry in the United States. And you see in the telecom, in the kind of emerging internet industry now, you've got three big mergers that are about to happen, you know, Comcast and AT&T now with whatever it is, and then T-Mobile with Sprint. And so these are some of the things that, you know, and plus the minimum wage has been kept low. The other thing is taxes. When the tax, this is a fascinating thing, Pap. If you go back and you look at the history of the United States over the last 100 years, and you can see the same thing in other developed industrial countries over the last 200 years. Whenever the top tax rate, after someone makes about $2 million a year, whenever that top tax rate exceeds 50%, you get stability. We didn't have a single bank failure or a single crash from 1935 until basically this, you know, those last one. I mean, there was a pretty bad one in 87, right after Reagan dropped the top tax rate from 74% down to 28%. And then the reason why is because when money is dear, when it's, you know, that first $2 or $3 million, you can make that easily. But after that, it's really hard to make money. Then people tend to invest very cautiously. Whereas when money is cheap, when money is easy, when you're rolling in dough, when you can make $2 billion a year as a Wall Street bankster, then people start looking for wild returns because, hey, they don't care if they lose every now and then. You know, there's lots more where that came from. And so you get these bubble economies. And so basically, ever since Reagan dropped that top tax rate below 50%, we have lived through a series of bubbles. And first you had the stock market bubble with Reagan and the SNL bubble and the stock market bubble. Then you had the dot-com bubble through Clinton. Then you had the real estate market bubble through Bush. And we're now back in another stock market bubble that the Fed is trying to reinflate. And we are going to continue with these bubble pop, bubble boom, crash economies or cycles in our economy until we raise that top marginal tax
rate. And every time a bubble bursts, the middle class disappears a little bit more.
The people get hurt, and the banksters make a fortune because they win no matter what happens.
What we hear the conservatives, I mean, there's a really ugly undertone to what the conservatives say about a prosperous middle class.
Yeah.
And it is that if we have a prosperous middle class, that people start to expect more. They demand more because they're used to more.
Yeah.
And they, the conservative looks at that as, oh, that's awful. Because, I mean, if, gee whiz, you know, if they demand right, maybe they demand civil rights. Maybe they demand women's rights. Maybe they can demand consumer rights, or maybe they're anti-war. And the conservative, the conservative dialogue is, if you give them too much, they will want more, and that's going to kill this country. I mean, if that's really kind of their bottom line when they talk about it.
It's not just their bottom line, it's their Bible. Russell Kirk in 1951 or 52 wrote a book called The Conservative Mind that animated Barry Goldwater, that was, you know, Ronald Reagan's marching orders, that William F. Buckley talked about at least once a month on Firing Line. And to this day, it's still in print and still a bestseller. It's the conservative Bible. And in that book, in 51, he said, if this trend toward a middle class continues and the middle class gets large enough and empowered enough, we are going to have social chaos in the United States. Now, Jefferson would look at social chaos and think it was a good thing. You know, he thought America should have a revolution every 20 years. A progressive would see these as positive changes. Conservatives, Buckley famously said, you know, a conservative is a man who stands athwart the arc of history with his hand out shouting, stop. Conservatives see
change
this as
scares
bad,
them,
right? They see, you know, they want slow, gradual change. And so what happened in the 60s and 70s as the middle class hit literally its peak in the history of the United States is women demanding rights, African-Americans demanding rights, gay people. Stonewall was, I think, 1969 or 71. Gay people demanding rights, Hispanics demanding rights. There's a whole movement around that. Young people saying, hell no, I won't go off to war. I mean, you just had this explosion. And the conservatives were convinced it was the end of America as they knew it.
Yeah,
and
Richard Perlman wrote The Nixon Land, which is all about that, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Very idea that we should have a society where we try to work cooperatively with each other, and we try to say, okay, well, we can all do better together. That's very scary to the conservative mind.
Well, it is. They see it as a zero-sum game.
Yeah.
Thom
Hartmann, you've written more great books. We're going to have them up on our site with this interview. You have a segment called Great Minds. Somebody has to interview you on this. want that said.
Bless you, Pat. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Tom.
Thanks so much for having me.
Corporate America has no problem using our infrastructure, our roads, our schools, military, and our economy to make billions of dollars in profit. But when it comes to paying taxes to fund those things, they leave the average citizen holding the bill. They've now come up with a new plan to avoid paying taxes, and I have Michael Burg here to talk about that newest scam. Mike, I can't think of anybody's, I can't think of a company having a worse nightmare than Mike Burg coming after him. And that's what you've done with Pfizer forever. I think they have special memos saying, how do we stop this guy from uncovering all of these awful things we've done? So it's kind of fun to talk about this story with you. Pfizer, now we see now the AstraZeneca deal as of today has not come together. AstraZeneca says $106 billion isn't enough. And so, but people are missing why Pfizer is so set on buying a foreign corporation like AstraZeneca.
Well, you know, first of all, Pfizer wants this so badly. I heard this morning they've upped their offer to 130 now, 130 million. It's trying to keep
billion,
the deal
alive. 130 billion.
30 yeah. billion, I'm sorry. Yeah, there's a big difference. To try to keep the deal alive. And what they want it for, which is just so ironic, is they want to buy them so they can move their headquarters strategically, not really move their headquarters. They're going to stay in New York, but strategically have a company that's now going to be a British company to try to save money on taxes, to lower the tax rate somewhere between 5 and 6%, which is hilarious considering all the tax breaks they get here, which include, you know, $73 billion in profits and paying nothing for those offshore profits here in the United States. It's really unbelievable.
Mike, what I find is so extraordinary is they take our infrastructure. They take our police officers, our fire department, our roads, our bridges. We give them money for Medicare. They make more money in VA and for tax. And this is taxpayers. This is me and you and people watching this program. Our tax money goes to things like making sure Pfizer gets to take as much money as they want from the VA, as much money as they want from Medicare. And it still isn't enough for these greedy bottom feeders. And this is a true bottom feeding company. I mean, there's no other way I can describe Ian Reed, who's the CEO of that corporation.
Right. It's absolutely correct, Michael. And what's even more infuriating is that a lot of the research that is done is actually paid for by us, the taxpayers, to allow them to get new products on the market. We pay for the R&D. Now what they're saying, we don't want to pay the taxpayer back. We don't want to pay our fair share. What we want to do is we want to have these outrageous profits, and we don't want to pay to help the U.S. and the U.S. economy.
Mike, I heard you give a speech one time, and I was very impressed with it, about you focused on Pfizer and a couple of other companies. And you talked about the idea of it's all about short-term big profits. The CEO, like Ian Reed, for the CEO of Pfizer, comes to the company, and he's there and gone in 5 years. And your point was that CEOs used to hang around for 25 years. Why has that happened? How is it that CEOs have made this into such a big cash cow for themselves?
Well, because it's all about greed. It's about that short-term fix. The problem we have here is the CEOs of the past with drug companies, they were interested in making sure they got good products, which we got a fair price for, and it really could help people in throughout the world, in the United States and world. And what I've always say, I like drug companies, but I want to be honest. Here, these CEOs, they're interested in how much money can I make as quickly as possible and put a good portion of that money in my pocket, and then I'm gone. I'll make $10, $20 million a year or more in stock options, then they're gone.
So here we have a company that wants to take everything they can suck out of the American taxpayer and say, you know, we don't really believe in America. We don't have any sense of patriotism towards America. We really don't give a damn about America. We're going to take everything you can give us. We're going to stay on 42nd Street there in New York City. And we're going to take our operation, though, over to London. to where we don't have to pay any taxes. See, isn't this part of the problem, Michael? And I think we've talked about this before, but I think it's important. There is no number that you can give a corporation and say, would you please, please God, please just pay this little bit of tax. There's no number you can give them because they don't want to pay any taxes, do they?
No, they don't. They brag about it. They brag about it. They came out. Pfizer said one of the reasons we want to do the deal is because we don't want to pay the tax. Now, that is, to me, anti-American. It's against the U.S. taxpayer. We pay our fair share. We pay, we pay ordinary rates. We don't get any breaks. The bottom line is here, though. They're still going to be in New York. They want to be in New York. They want to have their headquarters here. But the company wants to be a British company to avoid that. But there's a way to fight them on this, Mike. There's a way to fight them.
What do you do?
Well, let me tell you. What you do is you say, you know what? We're not going to allow you to do this. In fact, you're going to be taxed, whether it's through a special tax, for all the sales that occur in the United States. We're going to have an ad valorem tax. We're going to have an add-on tax for you, a foreign company, selling here now in the United States. And otherwise, you're not going to be allowed to sell your goods here. And we know we're the largest market in the world for Pfizer and all the other giant companies. And if Congress would just pass that law and say, we're going to punish you, people that are leaving the United States, going abroad, and coming in here and selling your products, we're going to hit you with the tax.
Well, Mike, couldn't we also just say to them, all these government contracts you have with the VA, kiss those goodbye. All of these government contracts you have to sell for Medicare, kiss them goodbye. Kiss goodbye this prohibition, and this is remarkable. This administration has allowed this prohibition to stay in place where Medicare can't even negotiate with Pfizer for how much Pfizer charges. Pfizer has a history of charging 10 to 20,000% in profit margins on their product. 10 to 20. And they say, oh, God, we had to do that for research and development. But it's not for research and development. It's for profit. So we can punish them right now, can't we? We can prohibit them doing business with our government agencies.
We can. And it would be wonderful if we would. It's about time that the president and the Congress stand up to these giant corporations. You know, we're in economic distress here. We have a huge debt. To allow these giant corporations who make billions and billions and billions of dollars to not pay their fair share is absolutely in the face of what America stands for. The little guy pays, the big guy pays, and the giant corporations making billions and billions are paying nothing.
Well, what this has been described as is kind of a giant predatory extraction machine. And what I mean by that is they take everything from us. They take our subsidies, as you've pointed out. They take our tax breaks. They take our government contracts. They use all of our infrastructure. When they're at threat overseas, our military is there for them. But they don't want to pay for that. They want the consumer to pay for it, and then they want to charge the consumer a 10,000% markup on a simple pill. I mean, at some point, don't you have to say, okay, go do business there? You're gonna this void that you leave here in the United States will be filled up by somebody who actually cares about this country and can actually call themselves an American citizen. Michael, let me shift here just a second. This whole nature of this new idea of shareholder, this what they call shareholder value ideology.
Right.
You've seen this firsthand in some of the Wall Street cases that you've handled. What is this notion of shareholder value ideology? What kind of a scam is that when you hear a CEO talking about that?
First of all, it's a hoax. The whole thing's a big hoax. What they're saying is we have a fiduciary duty to our shareholders to increase our profits to the maximum. Now, what they're not saying is their other fiduciary obligations and their moral obligations that they have to this country and to the people at large. And what it's leading to, which is happening here, is this hoax of fiduciary duty is leading for what we see on Wall Street, which is criminal activity. Criminal activity increased the profit. Or here, the activity of going overseas, in which, quite frankly, it would be a hoax. Pfizer's the largest drug company in the world just because they buy AstraZeneca. For $130 billion, that's a small portion of what they have. It's nothing more than just trying to grab a foothold. What we need to do is to fight that back. It is not fiduciary duty for profit at all costs to cheat, to lie, to steal.
What they want to say is our fiduciary duty is to steal. Our fiduciary duty is to cheat. Our fiduciary duty is to be un-American. That's our fiduciary duty. And what you're seeing is hardly any pushback on this from the media and saying, you have a fiduciary duty to this country. We have allowed you to prosper in this country. We've allowed you to become the Pfizer that you are today. And by God, you've got a responsibility to the people in this country. And I think there needs to be some very, very serious, reconsideration on how we treat a company like Pfizer. Well, Mike Burg, keep going after them, okay?
We will. Thank you.
To keep them honest on your end. Thanks a lot for joining me. Uh-huh. Bye-bye.
Thanks, Mike.
So, Pap, we talked a little bit about last week I was talking a little bit about how the Tea Party, some of the major Tea Party groups are raising a ton of money and not spending on anything except for their own consulting fees. None of it's going to their candidates. But and there's a lot of talk about how the so-called establishment is supposedly in ascendancy in the Republican Party. I don't buy it.
Is in ascendancy? Oh, no. God, no. That's so wrong. I see those articles, too. That gets PR.
That is PR. And I think to a certain extent, what they're trying to do is just they realize going into an election that they have to tamp down the crazies in their party just so that they can still appeal to normal human beings. Sadly for them,
every day you got another story.
Sadly for them, it's not working because we know what's happening with basically from whence, and we've talked many times in the past that when you start to see some type of national Republican issue and you're just like, that's completely crazy. How has that reached a national level? We know where it starts.
Yeah.
It starts with the state senators who are Republicans. It starts with the Republican candidates throughout the states. And this week, we can see there's more of these stories out there that give you a sense of where the Republican Party is headed and where they're coming from.
Well, I mean, it's not just the party. I mean, it's the spokesman for the party. It's the guy that every town. I mean, let's just take the preacher that just said that, and this guy's a huge Republican kind of voice. He says, women who wear yoga pants, they invite being raped. I mean, that's one of them. You saw the story this GOP candidate that opposed marriage equality. He worked as a drag queen. He worked as a damn drag queen, and he's out there opposed to marriage equality. Talk about this story. This is almost every other day GOP kind of story.
There's a candidate for the North Carolina State Senate, a Republican, a guy named Steve Wiles, and a report published in the Winston-Salem Journal this past week said that he had a stage name at one point, and that was Miss Mona Sinclair. He was a drag queen and a promoter for the Miss Gay America pageant. Now here's the thing.
Well, what's bothersome about it to me is he's opposing gay marriage. That's the story.
That's exactly it.
He can dress up like Shirley Temple for all I care, but don't come out and with an angle like that.
Yeah, he comes out.
Carmen
and
Miranda
is,
put fruit on his head. I don't care.
He's in favor of a constitutional amendment to ban marriage equality in North Carolina, and he refuses to address the question as to whether or not he is a so-called ex-gay, because within these within these sort of the conservative mindset, you can go and apparently
go to a class.
Yeah, you can go to class and hit a tennis racket on a couch or something, and all of a sudden your sexual orientation changes.
No, go to Michelle Bachmann's husband's clinic.
But here he is. He's talking about why he doesn't believe that marriage equality is the same thing as being anti-gay. He says, I don't really understand how you can separate the fact that marriage is a religious institution. But the reality is, in this country, marriage is not merely a religious institution. It is an institution recognized by the state that offers literally over 1,000 new rights that you get if you are married. Now, if this guy comes out and he says, I want a constitutional amendment that says that the state can only promote civil partnerships, and marriage is only something that can be bequeathed upon you by a religious institution. But when you go down to get a marriage license, you're not getting it from the church. You're getting it from City Hall.
Well, look, and Sam, here, the discussion, though, we start this discussion and we say, how is it that the GOP distances itself from crazy? How do you do that? You can't do it when you have a GOP candidate out there doing that. You can't have it when you have a GOP spokesman saying that women who wear yoga pants basically deserve to be raped.
Right.
You can't do it when you have Fox News. The latest Fox News stories, Benghazi, this is Benghazi obsession. The story that they're reporting is about the fact that President Obama is going to, he's going to interview meteorologists from all over the world and make a statement about climate change. So they say that it won't mean anything unless the meteorologists have the opportunity to question him about Benghazi. Now, I can't make that up.
No.
The other story, I mean, there's so many. Every other day there's a story. Sam, we could do this every day and have five great stories to talk about. The GOP has lost its touch, and the idea that they're now there's this new ascension
of the establishment. I don't buy it.
That's nonsense.
And look, we see it in terms of Obamacare. We could talk about Obamacare maybe in the next segment, but there have been very good numbers in terms of signups. There's been there are new reports out there on the implications of Obamacare for mortality rates and whatnot. But with that said, this has been the sort of the Republican, they, I don't know, 52 times they try and repeal it. And then you have guys like this state senator, a guy named
Greg Bennett
State. Well, I'm talking about Stacey Campfield.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Of Knoxville, Tennessee. Now, he's out there. Now, of course, he is part and parcel of this Republican machine. He has not gotten the message yet that they're not going to repeal it, that they can't talk about it anymore because people are starting to come out and say, hey, this saved my life or whatnot.
Right.
So he goes and he posts on, I think it was Facebook, his thought of the day. Democrats bragging about the number of mandatory signups for Obamacare is like Germans bragging about the number of mandatory signups for the train rides for Jews in the 1940s. This past week, there were Gallup polls that showed that the number of uninsured in this country has dropped to its lowest level since Gallup started keeping records of this. It is clearly a function of Obamacare. There are reports out there now that when they've looked at what happened in Massachusetts when they instituted Romney Care, very much like Obamacare, that mortality rates have started to go down in Massachusetts. So in light of all this, what do you do if you're a Republican candidate? What if you do if you're a Tea Partier? Well, you start saying this is like sending Jews to the gas chambers.
Well, again, Greg Brannon, this story is so insane. You have Greg Brannon, who's Republican/Tea Party candidate. I mean, it's just a moving target. They're all the same thing. But what ends up happening here is you've got him saying, I've really analyzed all this. I mean, I'm a smart guy.
Now we should say this guy is a Republican candidate for U.S. Senate.
Yes, North Carolina. And so he says, I've analyzed this, and I'm really, really a smart guy. And what I've come up with is I've come up with the idea that I've proven that there is a death penalty built into Obamacare, And we, you know, we can show you that. He goes off talking about, his, this is great, just like we did in 1866, he says a slave is a piece of property, a human being with inalienable rights. And now what we're not even giving the, we're not even giving, I guess, old people is what he's talking about that are on this death panel. We're not even giving them those rights because it's suggesting that we're killing them intentionally with Obamacare. I mean, that's what this is another one of those stories where you have the Republican Party saying, "Oh no, we're new and improved. We're not the crazy people anymore. You know, we saw a psychiatrist. We're on Zoloft. We've been cured." Well, this is a story like that's every day. I mean, every day there's a
Greg Brannon.
We
should say the death penalty he's talking about is something called the Independent Payment Advisory Board.
Right.
It's a 15-member independent government agency that looks for inefficiencies in Medicare payments. And so if they because they run the biggest insurance company in the country, that is Medicare, they look and see and they say, hey, you know what? These treatments, they don't work because we see a recidivism rate. We're not going to reimburse for these treatments at the rates that we've been reimbursing. That's all it is. It's just absurd. And the notion that constitutes a death panel, well, he should call up his private insurance companies and say, hey, you know how you're not reimbursing me for X, Y, and Z? That's a death panel too. It's just absurd.
That's it for this week's Ring of Fire, but you can keep up with us throughout the week online at ringoffireradio.com or on Twitter at Ring of Fire Radio and on Facebook. I'm Mike Papantonio. We'll see you next week right here on Ring of Fire.